Hi, I'm Andre, and today I'd like to introduce you to the ELK stack, ELK, which stands for Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. And today I'll begin with Logstash because it's a great tool on its own and you don't need to have any of the other tools like Elasticsearch and Kibana to use it. On this VM, I've already installed Logstash, which if you install it by package, installs in opt logstash. It's the current version, it's 2.3.4. And let's begin by creating the most simple logstash configuration you can create. All you have to have is a data input and a data output, and they don't need to contain anything. This is the most simple logstash configuration you can have. Nothing in, nothing out. Let's run Logstash with this, and you'll see it starts a pipeline. It has nothing more to read from the input. It will shut down. Now let's do something more meaningful and add a file input. File is an input plugin you can use to read normal text files. In this case, we'll use a file called input.log. And we'll just output the same data into a file called output.log. Now let's create the input log first, so it has something to read. And in the other window, we'll just do a tail on the output log, so we can see what happens when Logstash copies the input to the output. So now we start up Logstash again with the, well, still basic, but more advanced configuration. Takes a couple of seconds. There we are. Now let's put something into the input log just by echoing something into it. Could be a web server access log, something that will be written to constantly, and there we have it. A couple of seconds after we added something to the input log, it was copied to the output log. Now you can see why Logstash works great with Elasticsearch, because what you see here is already a valid Elasticsearch document. It contains the message, which is the original log line. It contains a version number, so you can add upon your existing data without having to delete anything. It contains the timestamp when this log line was processed, the path where the data came from, in this case, well, the path of the input file, and the host that generated this log. So let's edit the configuration again. Let's make the output log file a little more readable by using an output codec. And this time we'll choose plain for plain text. And we get something resembling a normal syslog output. Let's start up Logstash again. Now let's add some more text to our log file. By the way, Logstash will remember the position in the log file it was at. It will detect log rotation, so that's why we don't get any duplicates in this example. We'll always start at the end of the input log and get only the new lines that we put in there. Now there we have it, more or less syslog-like log message with the timestamp, the host where the log was recorded, and the log message. But still, this is not very readable because, as you can see, if we add more data to it, we will get all the log output into one line without any new lines in between, which makes it hard to read. But we can do something against it. For the codec, we now use the line output plugin, which will imply that we are using plain text output. And it will put one input line onto one output line. Start up again, and you can see each time we put a line in, we get a line out. And the line output can do some more fancy stuff. We can format the outputs. Right now we've got hardly any more variables than the message itself. And we'll use it here as the output format, so we don't get the timestamp or the hostname, just the log line. And by this, we are basically mirroring the input log to the output log. Let's put some more data in. So now the output is the same as the input. Now let's make the Logstash configuration a little more complex, because usually you don't want to just copy log files. Maybe you want to do some more log processing. And what we're doing here is we're adding a filter section. Data goes into the input, gets processed in the filter section, and will go out the output. The filter plugin we're using here is Grok. Grok is used to process unformatted data in log files into separate variables. And for now, we just assume some basic access log or something. We get a verb like get or post, we get a URI, and a number of bytes that have been sent by this document. And once we start Logstash, I'll show you where this excels over something like SED or org, because until now you might have said, okay, I can do this all in SED or org or something else. But now you see, if I put the same data into the log file, it cannot process the data, because Logstash actually tries to recognize a couple of data types. We said the verb was a string or a word. We said the URI is a path. And we said the number of bytes is actually a number. And Logstash won't do anything until it recognizes these three data types in succession, because that's what we told it to look for in the log file. And just so we don't get any unnecessary outputs whenever Logstash encounters a log line it can't process, we'll now add a conditional in the output and say, okay, only put the formatted output log, only write the formatted output log if you've got all the three variables filled. And if you haven't got those variables, or if you haven't got any content in those variables, we'll just write an error message to the log file. See, we just say it's a malformed message and output the original message. Now let's give this a try. And when we put valid data in, we get valid data out. If we put invalid data in, we get our error message. So this is it for this video. It's just a basic introduction on what Logstash can do. There are literally dozens of input, output, and filter plugins you can use. But I just wanted to show you that it's quite easy to get started. Now, have fun with Logstash. And in the next video in this series, we'll use Logstash to get some data into Elasticsearch. Until then, I'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.